just for me, just for me, Jesus came and did it just for me, just for me, just for me. Just for me. Said, well, the cross will always represent the love God has for me. When the Lord of glory, heaven sent, gave all on Calvary, he did it just for me. Just for me. Oh, Jesus came and did it just for me. Oh, well, the cross will always represent the love God has for me. When the Lord of glory, heaven sent, gave all on Calvary, he did it just for me, me, just for me. Oh, said Jesus came and did it just for me. Said, well, the cross, the love came down, said he did it just for me, just for me, just for me. Oh, Jesus came and did it just for me, said, well, the cross. Said, when the Lord of glory, heaven sent, gave all on Calvary, he did it just for me, just for me. Jesus came and did it just for me.
Good morning, New Bethel. I said, good morning, New Bethel. The Bible declares that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And we are so glad this morning to celebrate the joy of our risen Savior, our Lord and Jesus Christ. Is anybody excited this morning that we have a risen Savior this morning, that he got up so we can get up in our lives? Amen. Let us stand all over the building as we lift up our doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Thank you.
heads for a moment of prayer. Dear Heavenly and gracious God, God, we are grateful for you, O God, for waking us up this morning, for allowing us to arrive here safely, O God, that we get to see another day, O God, that is filled with new grace and mercies, O God. God, we say thank you. God, we are thankful, O God, for your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, a Savior who not only died on the cross for our sins, but rose again from the dead so that we could have a victorious, overcoming life here on earth. Dear God, we ask that you just help us to walk in the power of that resurrection. Oh, God, while we are here in this worship service, oh, God, we ask that you open our eyes and our ears, our hearts, our minds, that we can see you more clearly and see the life that you are calling us to live, the life of abundance, oh, God, the life of victory, oh, God, that we can walk out of these doors renewed, restored, and continue the work that you have called us to do. Continue the journey that you have called us to travel and do the work that you are calling us to do. Dear God, we say thank you. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Turn your mic on.
Good morning.
There you go.
There you go, John.
Hey, before I go there, let me bless us this morning. The preacher this morning said, good morning, God. So everybody in here need to say, good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the text. Matthew 28, 1 through 10. And it reads, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has been risen. He has been raised. And as he said, come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly to tell the disciples he has been raised from the dead. And indeed, he is going ahead on to you, Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message to you. So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, greetings. And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers and sisters to go to Galilee. There they will see me. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
Where I
standing shamefully in a courtroom, surrounded by demons on my left and angels on my right. Satan as the persecutor, holding millions of records about my life, and God sitting on a throne with a mighty gavel in his hand. I had no lawyer. Placed on trial for things such as lying, stealing, and fornication. For this was the beginning of my tribulation, for there was no reason to plead an innocent statement, for all the evidence was sitting right there with Satan. The demons smiled as tears rolled down the judge's eyes, for they clearly knew that now was the hour of my demise. But wait. In came a light shining so bright that the demon smiling suddenly jumped with fright. And the man that walked in that night was none other than Jesus Christ. Darkness departed to give way, and glory was all the angels could say. As the man that walked in that night pulled out a lighter and immediately set Satan's records against me on fire. He took the sentence file and erased my name, looked at me in the eyes and said, "Daughter, I'll take the blame." Handcuffs were placed on this man and he was thrown to the ground. The entire courtroom gasped at this horrendous sound and the sudden cease, the beat of his heart. The man that walked in glowing had now become dark. I did this to him. My lying, my stealing, my cheating. And he took the pain and spent 3 days in the hell that I was to go to for eternity. I left the courtroom that day. And there was nothing I could say. I was found innocent, for Christ handled the debt that I was to pay. This type of love is more than you could give to a girlfriend, boyfriend, husband, wife. This man died for me. I owe him my life. And even though my life is not at all worth it, how could you ever trade preference for perfect? See, I gave my life to Christ and suddenly picked up a mop. The lying, cursing, cheating, all that had to stop, because my life had been bought. And it'd be a shame to sit there and do nothing but let it rot. I'm not perfect, and the will to sin hasn't completely diminished from my life. But I believe Jesus' words when he died for me on that cross. It is finished.
Come on, if you're glad he did a finished work on the cross, will you stand all over the building? Come on, happy Resurrection Sunday. Anybody glad that the Lord stayed there just for you and I? And then they say 3 days later, he got up with all power in his hands, and we're thankful for his power. So we're going to sing about how high and lifted up the Lord is, but we're going to have a big choir in the sanctuary, if that's all right. Come on, we're going to rock from side to side and put our hands together like one big family. Come on, the song is so easy. It says this.
By the song you are.
Oh,
you, oh Lord. We praise you, oh Lord. We praise you, oh Lord. High and lifted up, oh Lord. We praise you, oh Lord. We praise you, oh Lord. We praise you, oh Lord. High and lifted up. All right, now, so you already got on your Sunday best. I'm handing you the praise and worship microphone this morning. And listen, even if it's shower singing good, that's all right. Because we're singing about the risen Savior. Is that all right? You know what I'm going to ask you to do? Find you somebody and smile at them. Tell them good morning, first of all. Come on. Now you tell them, we're going to sing about a high and lifted up God. Come on, some of y'all looking at me and you looking at your neighbor. You about to sing to your neighbor. All right, here we go from the top right here. I'm going to sing with y'all, but y'all sing with me. Here we go. Let's say,
oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, we praise you. Oh, Lord, high
is you say.
Lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. We are here because God should be high and lifted up in our lives. I want to, at this time, welcome all of our first-time visitors. If you are a first-time visitor, will you please stand where you are? Don't worry, no one is going to ask you to say anything. No Easter speeches, nothing like that. Just stand where you are, and our ushers have a little something for you. So welcome to New Bethel AME Church on this morning. If you are online, just type in the chat, first time. We want to welcome you. Please remain standing until our ushers bless you with a little something that you will then return so that we can thank you for being here with us on this Sunday. Amen. We want to lift up the work of our food pantry. As they continue to be a blessing to those in our community this past week, 84 families were served at our food pantry. For this year, we have been a blessing to 1,620 families through the work of our food pantry. Can we get a God a hand clap of praise for that? Amen. As New Bethel continues to serve as God's hands and feet in the world, we want to lift up a few things that we have going on that attempt to really be a blessing to the community. There'll be a blood drive happening April the 6th here at New Bethel from 10 to 2 p.m., sponsored in part by Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, Zeta Phi Beta, as well as Rho Beta Sigma and Sigma Omicron Zeta. On April the 13th, there will be a dental fair here at New Bethel AME Church. Can we say free? A free dental fair here at New Bethel AME Church for children zero, as in out the womb one day, to 12 years old. So you can bring your child. We will have a screening of your children for free. Can you say free again? All right. And we can register for that on the New Bethel newsletter, or you can reach out on our website for that information. Our 133rd church anniversary gala is coming. Not 131 or 132, but 133. Please get your tickets in the prophet room. We are going to have a great time in the Lord on April the 20th. Can you say April the 20th? Can you say April the 20th? We need to buy these tickets, folks. We had an anniversary last year, and we were busting at the seams. So we got a little more room for you to come, and we can celebrate with one another how God is being a blessing at New Bethel AME Church. Is anyone here in the fraternity sorority? Anyone here attending HBCU? Well, guess what? On April the 21st, we have our HBCU and Greek Sunday here at New Bethel AME Church. We want to see you in your full paraphernalia, as well as in your college and university attire. I will be wearing my Howard University swag, in case you were wondering. But we will accept Edward Waters College apparel as well on behalf of our wonderful pastor. On every Sunday evening, we have the Chosen Generation prayer call for our young adults from 9 to 9:20 p.m. every single Sunday. Our young people are coming together, praying together, finding out how God can move in their lives. That information is in the New Bethel newsletter. We also have the Atlanta East District Lay Organization will be hosting their Trailblazer Award program here at New Bethel on April the 20th from 2 to 4 p.m. Like I said, we're busy here at New Bethel. But we are busy doing God's work for God's people, trying to be God's hands and God's feet in the world. I will wrap up with just two more announcements. Today is the last day in March, and we've been observing Women's History Month. I would like all the women to please stand at this time. All the women, as you are able. As you are able, no, there won't be any gifts. I'm sorry, I apologize for that. But we do appreciate each and every one of you for all the work that you do, every last woman here, for being a blessing to our families, for being a blessing to our community, for being an example of the way in which Christ intended us for loving one another and for loving the church. So can we get a hand clap of praise for all the women here in our sanctuary, those who are watching online? Thank you, thank you, thank you. Each of you are responsible for making history in our community. So thank you so much. And just a reminder that our youth have their worship service usually on the first, second, and third Sunday, and that's in our prophet room or in the fellowship hall. But on the fourth Sunday, we worship together as a church family. So please, if you have your young people here on the first, second, or third, they have a wonderful, wonderful worship experience led by Reverend Angela, assisted by Reverend Stephen. And so we want to continue to let them grow and develop so that this day, this Resurrection Sunday, means something specific and special just for them. Not just because Mama and Daddy said Jesus is important, but that they have to learn for themselves why God is important for them in their lives. Amen. Amen. I will now turn this over to our Minister of Music, Sister Charity.
The Lord said, destroy this temple in 3 days, I will raise it up.
Destroy this
this song.
Back the stone.
Come on and say hallelujah. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Brothers and sisters, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. So good to have you this morning for our Resurrection Sunday. And we believe, as the choir has just ministered to us, that Christ has risen. So we are happy to have you with us this morning. I want to say a couple things as we prepare to give this morning. Friday night, we had an awesome time here in the Lord with our Good Friday revival. Bishop Walter Scott Thomas preached from the depths of his heart on Friday night. If you didn't have a chance to be with us and you wasn't present or online, go back. It's on our website and watch that service. This morning at the 7 o'clock service, Dr. Teresa Fye Brown preached a powerful word. Good morning. Powerful word this morning. If you didn't get a chance, go back and see it. Our young people showed out this morning and did an amazing job with our youth witness service. And we're so grateful for them and Reverend Angela and the youth ministry leaders. And you have gathered here for our 9:30 service in the presence of the Lord. Immediately following service, we have a number of selfie booths that are set up for you. If you would like to take a picture with your family, you can take a picture. And we also have a photographer who was able to print those pictures out for you. And so we are grateful to provide that for you on today. I want to say a special shout out to Sister Zandra Knight. Sister Zandra, would you please stand, please? Her business about last night. She does special events, and we are so happy to have her here at New Bethel with us. She provided all the decorations, put them all together hand by hand, and we are grateful for you. So if you have an event, please reach out to Sister Zandra. She will set you up and set you straight. It's giving time, brothers and sisters. I said it's giving time, brothers and sisters. It's giving time. And God has given us his son. Y'all missed that on today. I don't know what y'all came to do this morning, but God gave us his son. First sign of God's generosity to us. We believe that God is a generous God. God continues to give. And the truth of the matter is that you can never beat God's giving no matter how hard you try. The more you give, the more God will give back to you. So I'm encouraging you this morning. We are a tithing church at New Bethel. We believe that God gives us the tithe, and we give it back to God and trust God with the tithe. And so I'm encouraging you this morning, brothers and sisters, to give to the Lord. Trust God with your tithes and your offering. Trust God with your tithes and your offering. God has already given it to you. I told you that. It's already in your pockets. It's already in your purses. Already on that debit card, on Cash App, in the Zelle. It's already there. Just give to the Lord. Trust the Lord with your tithes and your offering. And I'm a living witness, and I know there are some living witnesses in the house who's given to God. God has given it back to you. He didn't just give it back to you, but he pressed it down and allowed it to run over in your life. So let us stand all over the church, brothers and sisters. Come on, ushers, lead us and guide us as we give in the ministry of generosity.
Show me when you gave your only. I really love. I really love. Oh, say, how can you? And then you. I really love you. I really love.
God, we thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus. Thank you for giving him to us. Thank you allowing him to die for us. We pray now, God, that as we've given to you what you've already given to us, bless it, use it, build your kingdom and your community. Make a difference in the life of someone. Your son, Jesus' name, we pray. People that love the Lord said amen, amen, and amen.
bought you. He died for you. And we're singing about the man who got up for you. And so will it be not bothersome to ask you to rest on your feet and testify with your mouth about the Savior who did something not for me, for you? Come on, tell somebody he died for me. Come on, tell somebody else he did it for me. Now we're going to take it back to the testimony part of the word there. And we just want you to lift it up with us. Is that all right? The story say it didn't end there. And I thank God it didn't end there. Come on, let's testify right here. Oh.
Come on, if you believe that, put your blessed hands together. Come on, come on, come on. You know there is no greater love that Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. That wretch part gets me every time because I be wrenching. You know what I'm saying? I'm still needing God to save a wretch like me. I know I'm not the only one. But when you look back over your life and you think things over and you think how good God's been, is there anybody in here that needs God to save a wretch like you? Give God some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Save a wretch. Save a wretch. God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this worship experience. Thank you for moving in this place. We pray now, God, that you let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart minister to your people, God. Have your way in this place. Hide me behind your sacred cross that you may get glory, honor, and praise. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. And the people that love the Lord said, amen. 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 There is a word from the Lord today found in the book of Mark, chapter number 16, verses 1 through 8. And here's what the word of the Lord says. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, the mother of James, Salome, brought the spices that they may go to anoint Jesus' body very early on the first day of the week. Just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb? But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." Verse 8, trembling and bewildered, the women went out, fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. And all that had been commanded them, they told. All they had been commanded, they told. I want to say a word this morning about no excuses, a season to be faithful. No excuses, a season to be faithful. My brothers and sisters, because we sit on this side of the resurrection, it can be easy for us to shout early Sunday morning. Early on Sunday morning that he got up with all power in his hands. We celebrate the resurrection with ease because our distance gives it a meaning and an understanding that flattens the terror and the confusion of these events. We get happy because he got up. But the folks in this story are bewildered. They are confused. They are in disbelief. And brothers and sisters, I suspect their experience of these events, their closeness to the events, gives them a sobering perspective about Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. This here is not an ordinary situation. The course of 1 week, things have went from amazing to terrifying and earth-shattering. How can somebody who was so loved, who was so honored, someone whose reputation was flawless, experience such betrayal and defeat in just a few short days? And as one of his followers, how could they not be shook by the fact that if they could do it to Jesus, not telling what they could do to them? And so, my brothers and sisters, you can imagine how much courage and resolve it took for these women to get up and to have it in their minds that they were going to give Jesus a proper burial. You can imagine how much they had to love Jesus to risk not only going in public, but going to do something that could have happily, that could have killed them and placed them in their own graves. Still, brothers and sisters, the women folks do what they got to do. Even when they had every reason and every valid reasons not to, what Jesus meant to them was worth the risk that they were taking. And maybe that's a lesson for us on this Resurrection Sunday, that we have come to know about Jesus and experience of Jesus that makes taking a risk worth it. Have you tried him? Do you know him? Have you found him to be a friend? Has he done anything for you that makes you want to love him? And if there's anybody in this house, that's your testimony, that's your experience of Jesus, makes you stare in the fear, in the face, and do what you've got to do, because you know that if you don't do it, it won't get done. The women, show us what it means to serve with no excuses. They are modeling for us the same courage that Jesus showed in his ministry. When Jesus knew the rulers were getting sick and tired of his ministry, Sick and tired of his ministry growing and getting around the barriers and the roadblocks, they decided that they were going to plot to kill him. And even when Jesus knew that what they were planning, he kept on doing what he was called to do. He still kept on going where he was called to go. Still kept on healing how he was supposed to heal. Jesus and these women showed some way, somehow, they were determined that they were not going to let nobody turn them around. Didn't matter what the haters said or what the haters did. It didn't matter how loud the voices in their own hearts were. They were determined to serve God with no excuses. They were willing to push past everything to go and see about Jesus. And if I can this morning, they were willing to push past their excuses. Excuses that they have in their minds. Excuses that are right in front of them. Excuses that come from previous traumas and experiences that keep them from going to see Jesus. I'm impressed this morning with the women. Because although they are afraid, although they are weary, although they are tired, they didn't let those things stop them from going to see about Jesus. Can I pause right here parenthetically and say that we all have reasons not to come and see Jesus? We all have lived experience that could stop us from going to see about Jesus. We all can find excuses that tells us that we don't have to go and see about the Master. But every now and again, we have to stand on business. We've got to stand on the stuff that matters. We've got to stand on the receipts. Every now and again, we have to pull out the receipts and remember what the Lord has done. We have to remember how the Lord looked out for us. We have to remember the mighty works of the Lord. But even in the still, in the midst, their plans were not unfolding as they expected. They were ready to do this work. But when they got to the site of what they expected to see was not how it was. And ain't that just like life, that when you finally muster up the courage to step out, to show up, you get there and you find out what you had planned on doing is not impossible because the situation is not all that you had anticipated. And so when what you do is when you the situation changes and the plans that you intended ain't possible anymore, they were worried how they were going to be able to roll away this 500-pound stone, the opening of the tomb, only to find out it was already removed and the body was missing. Here it is, brothers and sisters. Why are you busy worrying and trying to figure it out and trying to figure out how you're going to get here and how you're going to get there? The truth of the matter is that God has already worked it out. Is there anybody in here that can give God praise that thing that you were worrying about and wondering about and you made excuses about, God stepped in right in the nick of time and God worked it out for your good. So now they are not only dealing with the trauma of Jesus' death, but now they're dealing with a missing body. Body that has not experienced the honor of a proper burial and taking from its resting place. But friends, rest assured that when you show up to do what you got to do, even if what you expected to do is not possible, God will have a messenger there for you, a messenger there to give you next steps. And that right there is a reason to rejoice, because God does not leave us to ruminate in our own finite mind and to play all the worst case scenarios and to spiral into the darkest corners of your mind. Here it is. God sends a messenger to help you make sense of the situation. A messenger to give you a perspective to help you to see beyond what your eyes can see. The messenger tells them that he's not here, which they can already see, but he also clarifies why Jesus' body ain't there. It's not here because it's not been stolen, but because he has risen like he said that he would. His absence in the tomb is because he is risen. And my brothers and sisters, you have to understand that to rise is not simply to just to get up. To rise is literally to awaken with purpose, to awaken for a cause or a reason. It was not simply the case that Jesus was sleeping and woke up like any other day. But this proclamation that he is risen testifies to the awakening of his purpose, the rekindling of his mission and direction. And so the words of the messenger do not just tell them that Jesus is back from the dead, but that his coming back to life has a purpose and a meaning and an understanding. And we know that part of that meaning is to fulfill what the scriptures have said. Just as he told them he would rise, it has now happened. And so the messenger just doesn't stop at telling them about Jesus, but also gives them instructions for others. Go and tell the disciples that he has gone ahead of them to Galilee and they will see him there. Jesus' mission is to get his disciples to show himself to them so that they will not only know that the tomb is empty, but that he is still alive just as he said he would. But this doesn't land on the three sisters as good news. In fact, the scripture says it makes them even more terrified and shocked, and they do what most of us would do. They get out of the graveyard as soon and as fast as they can and don't say anything to anybody else because they are afraid. And it might seem on the surface that even the resurrection is failure, because even though the women started with no excuses, by the time they end, they are scared, they're speechless, and what seems like good news does not feel like good news. But the story, brothers and sisters, doesn't end right there. It doesn't end with their fear. It doesn't end with their fear. And even for us now, there is good news. And that good news is that even when we are paralyzed by fear, Jesus still goes ahead of us, because Jesus is risen with a purpose. And there is no amount of fear that we have, no amount of doubt that we carry, no amount of questions that we raise, none of that, just like death, that can keep Jesus from doing what he set out to do. And so, brothers and sisters, I don't know about you. I know that in my own personal journey, there have been some terrifying moments, and even when I could not see Jesus, Jesus was still going ahead of me. Even when I could not fix my mouth to pray and my lips to offer praise, Jesus was going ahead of me and still making a way for me. And to these sisters' credit, even in their fear, they came to understand that there was nothing, that there was nothing more for them in the graveyard. And for somebody on this morning, that is good news for you, that you ain't got to stay confused at the graveyard. Don't let your fear lock you in an empty tomb. Don't let your fear keep you stuck around dead things. Get yourself up out of there, because if Jesus ain't there, ain't no reason for you to stay in there. And so, my brothers and sisters, the women run off terrified and afraid, and don't talk to nobody about what happened. They are terrified until they get to their destination. This is the gift of this story, that it reminds us that you can be afraid and still complete the assignment. You can be afraid and still complete the mission. You can still be afraid and still do what you got to do. You can be terrified and still show up to what you've been asked to do. The scripture tells us that they were afraid and they did all that had been commanded upon them. And as I get ready to go to my seat on this morning, as I get ready to go to my seat, I just want to talk to some folks this morning who feel paralyzed by fear. I want you to know on this morning that you are in good company. Because God does not use fearless folks. God uses faithful folk. I'm going to say that again for the people in the back because I don't think y'all heard it. God does not use fearful folks, but God uses faithful folk. On Monday, you could stop by and ask Abraham, who was called to go somewhere he had never been, and a father, a child in his old age. He was afraid, but he was still faithful. And did not God come through for him? On Tuesday, you can ask Moses, who was certain that he didn't have what it took to stand against Pharaoh. He was afraid and fearful, but he was still faithful. And did not God do what God said God would do? On Wednesday, you can ask Naomi and Ruth, whose options had left them wondering how they were going to make it. They were afraid, and they were still faithful. And did not God make their latter end better than their former? On Thursday, you can ask David, who found himself hiding in a cave, afraid of Saul, but faithful to promise God gave, and did not God come through and establish his throne forever? On Friday, you can ask the three Hebrew boys in a fiery furnace, afraid of fire, but faithful to the God of Israel, and did not God bring them out? All right. On Saturday, you can stop by Bethlehem and ask Mary, who was confused about could it be that she was with child, but she was faithful, and did not God make her the mother of the Savior of the world? And on early, on a Sunday morning, you can stop by a graveyard and ask these women, where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? Where is Jesus? Terrified and afraid, but faithful. I said they were terrified and afraid, but faithful. I'm going to say that again. They were terrified and afraid, but faithful. And they will tell you that he has risen just like he said he would. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad to know that we serve a God who doesn't let fear and terror have the final word in your life. A God who responds to our faithfulness with even more faithfulness. A God that keeps on keeping on and walks with you and talks with you and tells you that you're his. All I can say is hallelujah. Jesus has won the victory. Hallelujah. He's won it all for me. Hallelujah. Death couldn't hold him down. Why? Because you are the risen King. And I just wish that I was in a church this morning with some folks who were glad about serving a risen Savior and determined to not let their fear stop them from doing all that God has purpose for you to do. Don't let your fear keep you from starting that business. Don't let your fear keep you from entering ministry. Don't let your fear keep you from going back to school. Don't let your fear keep you from reaching out to say I'm sorry. Don't let your fear keep you from seeing the doctor and getting your health together. Don't let your fear win, but be faithful to do all that God has purposed and promised to do. And because he is risen, you can rise to your purpose. You can rise to your calling. You can rise to your life and life more abundantly. Somebody in here ought to shout yes. Somebody in here ought to shout yes. Shout yes. Shout yes! Every now and then, I go to the graveyard to visit my grandmother because I miss my conversations with her. I miss her strong rebuke, her laughter, her excitement. So sometimes I just go and drive to the graveyard. And the other day when I went to the graveyard to see her, noticed something strange that I've never seen before. That I was standing at her grave, and right across from me, there was houses right outside of the graveyard. And literally, if I took four steps, I would be with the living. All I'm trying to suggest to you on this morning, that you're in the graveyard. But all you got to do is take four steps and you will be among the living. I said all you got to do is take four steps and you will be among the living. The first step, you will say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The second step, you say, before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you. I set you apart. Third step will say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens thee. Fourth step will say, all things work together for them that love the Lord and called according to his purpose. Is there anybody in here that can say no excuses? No excuses. God, I'm trusting you. God, I'm trusting you. I'm going to walk out of the graveyard. I got to get out of the graveyard. I got to put my past behind me because God is up to something and God wants more for me. Is there anybody in here that can give God praise on today? Because God has already worked it out. Because God has already moved on your behalf. Because God has already been a way maker, been a miracle worker. Is there anybody in here that can say, I'm going to be faithful? I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to be faithful. Come what may, I'm going to be faithful. God, I love you, but I'm going to be faithful. God, I trust you, but I'm going to be faithful. God, I'm weary, but I'm going to be faithful. God, I'm tired, but I'm going to be faithful. Is there anybody in here? I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to serve while I'm hurt. I'm going to serve while I'm broke. I'm going to love while I'm hurt. I'm going to love when it hurts. Is there anybody in here that can say, I'm going to be faithful? No excuses. Season to be faithful. Let us stand all over the church. This is an invitation to discipleship.
You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death cannot hold. Seated in majesty, you are the risen King. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. You see.
My brothers and sisters, you heard the word of the Lord on today. God is speaking to us. You're not here by accident, but you're here on purpose. God has called you to be in this place at New Bethel for such a time as this. God is telling us on today, not just you, but me too. No excuses. This is a season to be faithful. No excuses. This is a season to be faithful. So our first call on today is the prayer of salvation. If you don't know Jesus for yourself, if you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, we invite you to come and give your heart, your soul, your mind to the one that will be with you every step of the way. A second call on today is church membership. Here it is. We would love to be your church family. I would love to be your pastor. New Bethel would love to share with you and to love upon you. We are a loving congregation, and we love to have you. So why don't you come? And then lastly, special prayer. If you're here and you're going through, you've been trying to do it all by yourself. You've been trying to figure it out. You think that you got the master plan. Come to tell you, you might have the master plan, but God has the blueprint for your life. So why don't you come this morning? As the choir continues to sing on this morning, God is calling you. God is speaking. Don't be stubborn. Come on, give your hand to God. God is speaking to you. God is saying, I want to do a new thing in your life. I want to make a difference in your life. Why don't you come on today? Come on. If you want to come and don't feel like walking, just raise your hand. We'll come to you. Look at your neighbor and say, is God speaking to you? They say no, say praise God. If they say yes, bring them on down. Turn to your next neighbor and say, is God speaking to you on this morning? If they say yes, bring them down. If they say no, say praise God.
You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. Hallelujah. You have won. Hallelujah.
God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your message. We thank you for those who responded on today. God, you already know what they need. You know what they stand in need of. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, God, that you would speak to them, that you would help them, that you would encourage them, that you would remind them that because he lives, we can face tomorrow. All fear is gone. We're thankful, God, that death could not hold you down. Death couldn't keep you in the grave. But God, you got up for each of us. And for that, we give you praise. God, we pray now, God, for Brother Quentin Peterson. God, we're grateful, God, that you found a heart for him. We're grateful, God, that even when we're fearful and afraid, God, you keep showing up, making a way out of no way. God, you keep moving in our lives. God, you keep on blessing us in ways that we cannot even explain. But thank you, God, for what you're doing for him. God, we pray now the heart would be successful. God, that it will work with his body. God, that he not have any side effects. God, that he comes out better than what he went in. God, we lift up those doctors. God, we lift up the nurses. We lift up his family, oh God, in the name of Jesus. God, we lift up him right now to you, oh God. God, give him the strength. God, give him the faith, oh God. God, give him the endurance to run this race, God. God, when you've done all of these great things, we thank you for the ministry of New Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church. God, we believe that it's your doing here at New Bethel. Not anything that I'm doing or the people doing, God. It's you moving in this place from heart to heart, from breast to breast, God. We thank you for loving us, for touching us, for anointing us, for purposing us, and for using us, God. We thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. God, we thank you for the Griffins who come to join our church on this morning. God, we thank you, God, for sending them our way. We pray now, God, in the name of Jesus, oh God, that you use them in this ministry, God. There's an assignment with their name on it. There's a place for them, God. So we ask that you would do it right now in the name of Jesus. God, when you've done all of these things, God, we give you honor, glory, and praise. It's in your son Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Come on and bless the name of the Lord. Welcome to New Bethel. So glad that you're here. My brothers and sisters, let us stand all over the church. We've had an awesome time in the Lord this morning. Come on, give it up for our music ministry, our music and Christian arts for leading us and making this worship experience such a wonderful day on today. Let us receive the benediction. No excuses. This is our season to be faithful. No excuses. This is our season to be faithful. So God, we pray right now that we will be faithful no matter what life brings, no matter the ups and downs, the curves, the twists, the roadblocks. God, we trust you and we're gonna be faithful. So bless the work of our hands. Go before us before we even get to work, before we even get to family dinner, before we even get out the driveway. Bless our cars. Bless the roads that we're going to drive on. Bless the houses that we live in. Bless the clothes that we wear. Bless everything that you allow us to have. Bless it in the name of Jesus. Now unto him who's able to keep us from falling and stumbling and present us faultless unto the only wise God, our Savior, dominion, power, and authority forever and ever. And the people that love the Lord shouted amen. 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 Come on, bless the name of the Lord in this place.